is taking my money or that I'm being devoured by a tiger, but actually, these are all creations of my mind. Asango hiyam purusha iti shrute. The Vedas say that the purusha, the atma, or the soul, has no connection with all its dreamlike material activities. Therefore, we must engage in this Krishna consciousness process to awaken from this dreaming condition. Above all, the fruitive laborers, speculators, and mystic yogis, above all the fruitive laborers, speculators, and mystic yogis are the bhaktas, or devotees of Krishna. A bhakta can be perfectly peaceful, whereas the others cannot, because everyone but the bhakta, everyone but the bhakta, one who has pure love, has desire. In other words, it's impossible for people to be peaceful in this world because they have so many material desires. The bhakta, or the devotee, only desires to please Krishna. So desire to please Krishna is effectively being desireless, meaning one is without material desires, but one has desires to please the Lord. A Sudha Bhakta, or transcendental devotee, is desireless because he is simply happy serving Krishna. He does not know or even care whether Krishna is God or not. He does not want to love He just wants to love Krishna. In other words, he does not know or even care whether Krishna is God or is not God. He just wants to love Krishna. Nor is he concerned with the fact that Krishna is omnipotent or that he is all-pervasive. In Vrindavana, the cowherd boys and the gopis did not know whether Krishna was God or whether he is not God, but they simply loved him. Although they were not Vedantists, great scholars, yogis, or karmis, they were happy because they were simple village girls and boys who wanted to see Krishna. This is a very highly elevated position called sarvapadivinirmuktam tatparatvena nirmalam, or the stage of purity in which one is liberated from all material designations. Although the yogis and karmis, close that door, although the yogis and jnanis are trying to understand God, they are not aware of their illusory condition. Maya sukaya bharam udvahato vimudan. They are fools because they are working hard for illusory happiness. There's no question of peace for them. The jnanis, or speculators, wanting to get relief from the hard work of this material world, reject this material world. They say, Brahma satyam jagan mitya. Brahma, or the state of the eternal effulgence emanating from the body of Krishna, is the truth, and jagan, meaning the material world, is false. Of course, that is not correct. Their position is a little higher than that of the karmis, or the materialists, because the karmis have taken this material world as everything. They say, here we shall be happy. And their dharma, or religion, consists of trying to make a peaceful atmosphere within this material world. The fools do not know that this has been tried for millions of years, but has never happened and never will happen. How can peace in the material world be possible when Krishna, the Creator himself, says that this place is meant for trouble and miseries? Abrahma bhuvanal loka punar avartina rirjana mam upetya tukonteya punar janma navidyate. Krishna says in the 8th chapter, 16th verse of Bhagavad Gita, from the highest planet in the material world down to the lowest, all are places of misery wherein repeated birth and death take place. So the point is, people are trying to find peace and sustainable happiness in this material world. But according to Krishna himself, the highest authority, it's not possible, because this world is a place of repeated birth and death. So how is there going to be peace? In fact, he says, anityam asukam lokam. He describes this world as anityam, temporary, and asukam, without happiness. And he also says, mamupetya punarjanma dukhalayam asasvatam, 8th chapter, 15th verse. He says, this place, the material world, is dukhalayam asasvatam. After attaining me, the great souls who are yogis in devotion never return to this temporary world, which is full of miseries. So, 8th chapter, 15th verse, 8th chapter, 16th verse, he describes the material world as a temporary place full of miseries. And nowhere in the material world, from Brahmaloka down to the lowest planet, it's just repeated birth and death, and it's places of misery. So then again he says, in the 9th chapter, Kim punar brahmana punya bhaktya rajasayas tata anityam asukam lokam imam prapya brajasvamam. He says, how much more, this is so of the righteous brahmanas, the devotees and saintly kings. Therefore, having come to this temporary miserable world, they engage in my loving service. So, again, in the 9th chapter, 33rd verse, 8th chapter, 15th verse, 8th chapter, 16th verse, he describes this world as a temporary miserable place full of says asukam, no happiness, and it's a place of repeated birth and death. So the people who say, well, if you follow our religion, or if you follow my system of yoga, if you do this, you do that, you will attain peace and happiness. It's not possible in the material world. If Krishna says it's not possible, then how is it going to be possible? Right. And why is it not possible? Because the material world is a prison house. People who revolt against Krishna are born into the material world. And they imagine that they will be successful, but their success is always punctuated with old age, disease, and eventually death. And then some people make up the false philosophy that the material world is false. It's completely illusory. Well, that's not possible either, because the material world, as Krishna says, bhumirapo nalo vayu kam mano buddhire vacha, it's an expansion of his inferior spiritual energy. It's spiritual. It's eternal. You can't destroy the material world. What is illusory is to think that I will find a permanent place of happiness and peace in this material world. That is an illusion. That is not possible. So, maya sukaya baram udvahato vimudan. Prahlad Maharaj says that people in this world are fools because they're working hard for illusory happiness. Dukalayam asasvatam. Not only is this world full of suffering, but is also temporary. One cannot simply agree to go ahead suffering the threefold miseries, that is, adhyatmika, adhibodhika, adhidevika, miseries of this body, miseries caused by other bodies, miseries caused by natural cataclysmic events. We can't simply agree to go ahead suffering the threefold miseries and stay here. Even that will not be allowed. in this world, one will not only be punished while staying here, but he will also be kicked out at the end. One may accumulate a large bank balance or an expensive home, a wife or husband, children, and so many amenities, and one may think, I am living very peacefully. But at any day, he may be told, please get out, meaning at any time, death can come or an accident can happen. Why, he will ask, it is my house and it is paid for. I have money and a job and responsibilities. Why should I get out? Just get out. Don't talk. Get out. On that day, a man sees God. Oh, I did not believe in God. So in other words, for the devotees, God is Krishna. But for the materialists who ignore God, God is death. Krishna will come as death. And therefore, the materialists and the atheists, they see God as death. Okay, Prabhu, close the door. Keep the door closed. On that day, a man sees God. Oh, I did not believe in God, he may think. But now, here is God finishing off everything that I have accumulated. Thus, it is said that the demoniac recognized God as death, for it is at that time that he takes everything away from them. Why do we want to see God as death? When the demon Hiranyakashipu saw Krishna, he saw him as death personified. But his son, the devotee Prahlad, saw him in his personal form as his beloved Lord. Those who challenge God will see him in his ghastly aspect, but those who are devoted to him will see him in his personal form. In any case, everyone will ultimately see God. A person who is honest can always see Krishna everywhere. Krishna says, try to understand me. Try to see me everywhere. By way of facilitating this method, the Lord says, Rasoham apsukonteya, I am the taste of water. When we are thirsty and need a glass of water, we can drink it and feel happy. Understanding that the power of water to quench our thirst is Krishna. Similarly, as soon as there is sunrise or moonshine, we can see Krishna, for he says, Prabhasmi sasi surayo, I am the sun and moon. At a further stage, we can see Krishna as the life force within everything, as he indicates in Bhagavad Gita, Punyo ganda prativyam cha, tejas chasmi vibhavaso, jivanam sarvabhuta bhutesu tapas chasmi tapasvisu. So this jivanam sarvabhutesu, I am the life of all that lives. And tapas chasmi tapasvisu, I am the penances of all ascetics. Once we understand that all things are dependent upon Krishna for their existence, there's no possibility of his ever becoming lost to us. In other words, if we see that at every step of our life, we depend on Krishna's mercy, then we will always be Krishna conscious. We will always be conscious of our relationship with the Lord. In Bhagavad Gita, the Lord indicates that all things abide in him, in both their beginning and in their end, and also in the interim state. In other words, at every stage of life, from the beginning, the middle, the end, we are always in relationship with Krishna, and we are always dependent on Krishna. Etad yoni nibhutani sarvanitu padaraya aham krishnasya jagata prabhava pralayastata matak parataram nanyat kintyad asti dananjaya mai sarvamidam protram sutre manigana iva. Of all that is material and all that is spiritual, and that is, these verses are Bhagavad Gita 7th chapter, 6th and 7th verse. Of all that is material and all that is spiritual in this world, know for certain that I am both its origin and dissolution. In other words, the beginning, the middle, and the end of everything. O conqueror of wealth, Arjuna, there is no truth superior to me. Everything rests upon me as pearls on a thread. So at no time are we separated from Krishna. And at all times, we are dependent on Krishna. The idea that we are separated from Krishna is illusion. There's no such thing as being separated from Krishna. But we can be forgetful of Krishna due to willful ignorance. Krishna is easily visible, but he is only visible to those who are devoted to him. For those who are envious, foolish, or unintelligent, he obscures himself with his veil of maya. Naham prakasasarvasya yogamaya saman vitraha mudoyam nabijanati mam ibyam param avyayam. Mudoyam nabijanati lokamam ajamavyayam. Krishna says, for those who are foolish and unintelligent, I'm never manifest to them. For them, I cover my eternal creative potency, maya. I am covered by my eternal creative potency, maya. Thus, the deluded world knows me not, who am unborn and infallible. So, Krishna's internal potency is called yogamaya, and Krishna's external potency is called Mahamaya. So we are covered by Mahamaya, and Yogamaya covers us from seeing Krishna. So we have two coverings that we have to overcome before we can see Krishna. This Mahamaya takes us away from Krishna. Okay, if you're going to talk, you can go outside and talk. When you're in the class, you have to listen. Right? The Mahamaya separates, takes us away from Krishna, and Yogamaya brings us closer to Krishna. This eternal creative potency, or Yogamaya, which observes Krishna, which obscures Krishna to the unintelligent, is dissolved by love. This is the verdict of Brahma Samhita. Premanjana churita bhakti vilochanena santak sadeva hridaye suvilokayanti. One who has developed love for Krishna can see him within his heart 24 hours a day. Those who thus see Krishna are not anxious because they know where they are going at death. So they're not worried. They know after death I'm going back to Krishna. Why do they know that? Because they're with Krishna right now, all the time, by remembering him and by serving him. Now, if we don't remember Krishna every day and we don't have any service for Krishna, then you should be really afraid of death because you don't know what's going to happen to you. But if you're engaged in Krishna's service and you're always thinking of him, how do we think of him? Well, we've been trained. You read the seventh chapter, it shows you how to recognize Krishna in everyday life. Punyo ganda prativyam cha tejas tasmi vibhavaso jivanam sarvabhutanam tapas tasmi tapas chasmi tapas visu. So this says, Krishna says, I'm the original fragrance of the earth and I am the heat in fire. And I am the life of all lives, and I am the penance of all ascetics. So, anytime you feel the heat and fire, okay, close the door. Anytime you taste, you see the fragrance of a flower, anytime Krishna says, Rasoham apsukonteya, I am the taste of water, anytime you feel your thirst quenched by drinking water, and Pravasmi Sasi Suraya, I am the light of the sun and the moon. Anytime you see the sunlight and the moonlight. Pranava Sarvavede Su, anytime you hear the syllable Om in the Vedic mantras. Om Purnam Ada Purnam Idam Purnat Purnam Udachate. These are all representations of Krishna. And sabde ke purusham nisu, whenever you hear sound in ether, sound, and whenever you purusham nisu, you see ability in man, those are representative of Krishna. So, if you read Bhagavad Gita and you learn it from a genuine devotee, you will be able to see Krishna every day, every minute of the day. Those who thus see Krishna are not anxious because they know where they are going at death. One who has taken the gift of Krishna consciousness knows that he will not have to return to this material world to take another body, but that he will go to Krishna. Okay, no whispering. Whispering is inauspicious, especially in the temple. If you have something to say, you step outside, you say it, and you come back. One who has taken the gift of Krishna consciousness knows that he will not have to return to this material world to take another body, but that he will go to Krishna. It is not possible to go to Krishna unless one attains a body like Krishna or Krishna's. In other words, a body that is Satchit Ananda Vigraha, a body that is full of eternity, bliss, and knowledge. A body full of eternity, bliss, and knowledge. One cannot enter into the fire and not perish unless he himself becomes fire. And similarly, one cannot enter into the spiritual realm or the spiritual world in a body that is not spiritual. In a spiritual body, one can dance with Krishna in the rasa dance, like the gopis and the cowherd boys. This is not an ordinary dance, but the dance of eternity in the association of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Only those who have become purified in their love for Krishna can participate in it. One, therefore, should not take this process of Krishna consciousness as something cheap, but as a matchless gift bestowed upon suffering humanity by the Lord himself. Simply by engaging in this process, all the anxieties and fears of one's life, which in actuality revolve about the fear of death, are allayed. So, this is the cause of mental sickness. People don't know what's going to happen in the future. They begin to worry. And then they have a disturbed mind. And then eventually they develop a serious mental illness. So, how to overcome mental illness? Become very secure in your faith in God and Krishna. And engage in his service practically, beginning by chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare. And by doing practical service, cleaning the temple, and so many other services are in the temple. So therefore, in the Bhagavad Gita, second chapter, 66th verse, it says, Nasti buddhira yuktasya, nacha yuktasya bhavana, nacha bhavyatak santira santasya kutasukam. It says that one who is not connected with Krishna through practical service, such a person can never have transcendental intelligence nor a steady mind. Without which, there's no possibility of peace. And how can there be any happiness without peace? So this is a very important verse. And in the purport, it explains the cause of mental illness. And the beginning of mental illness is worrying and anxiety because one is not sure what's going to happen in the future. One who is not connected with the Supreme and Krishna consciousness can have neither transcendental intelligence nor a steady mind, without which there's no possibility of peace. And how can there be any happiness without peace? Unless one is in Krishna consciousness, there's no possibility of peace. So it is confirmed in the 5th chapter, 29th verse, that when one understands that Krishna is the only enjoyer of all the good results of sacrifice and penance, Bhuktaram Yajna Tapasam. He's the only beneficiary of all sacrifice and penance. Sacrifice means you give something up. Penance means you do something to atone for a sin. And secondly, that he is the proprietor of all universal manifestations, Bhoktaram Yagyatapasam. And that he is the real friend of all living entities, Surhidam Sarvabhutanam. Then only can one have real peace. Therefore, if one is not in Krishna consciousness, there cannot be a final goal for the mind. Disturbance of the mind is due to want of an ultimate goal. And when one is certain that Krishna is the enjoyer, proprietor, and friend of everyone and everything, then one can, with a steady mind, bring about peace. Therefore, one who is engaged without a relationship with Krishna is certainly always in distress and is without peace. However much that person may make a show of peace and spiritual advancement in life, Krishna consciousness is a self-manifested peaceful condition which can be achieved only in relationship with Krishna. So now we know how you can tell if someone is a genuine devotee or not. If they're always worried, that means they don't really have faith in Krishna or God. And therefore, they're always worried, always complaining, always in anxiety, always have something to complain about. Therefore, their mind is disturbed. Krishna consciousness is a self-manifested peaceful condition. Why? Because self-manifested means in every situation, even in the most distressful situation, a devotee is not disturbed because the devotee has complete faith that Krishna will protect him. In fact, that is one of the symptoms of surrender to God. Surrender means saranagati. So in the 18th chapter, 66th verse, it explains the six symptoms of a person who is surrendered to God. Anukulyasya sankalpa, pratikulyasya varjanam, raksisyai siti vishvaso, gopchit tre varanam tata, atma niksepa karpanye sadvida saranagati. So these are six symptoms of surrender. One, anukulyasya sankalpa. A devotee who has actually surrendered Krishna will always accept everything for favorable to Krishna consciousness. Everything favorable for engaging in the service of Krishna. And pratikulyasya varjanam, the devotee will always reject anything that's not favorable to serving Krishna. And number three, raksisya siti visvaso, a devotee accepts that Krishna is his only protector. He doesn't depend on anything or anyone else. And guptritre varanam tata, a devotee does not have any other interest other than serving the Lord. His main occupation, his main activity in life, his main mental, preoccupation is serving the Lord. But in spite of that, the devotee can function in many other capacities, as a father, as an employee or a CEO, as a friend, as an uncle, as a neighbor. He can function in all those different relationships, but underlying everything is his dedication, his or her dedication to Krishna. And atma niksepa karpanye, accepting everything that happens as the mercy of the Lord, good or bad. The devotee is not disturbed by negative or adverse situations. Why? Because the devotee is dedicated to the service of the Lord. Therefore, he's not deterred, whether in success or failure. And Karpanye, the devotee is always meek and humble in the execution of devotional service. So these are six symptoms of surrender to the Lord. And the one that is most apparent is that the devotee accepts Krishna as his sole protector. is convinced that the Lord will protect him in all circumstances. Therefore, he's not worried. And it says here, simply by engaging in this process of Krishna consciousness, all the anxieties and fears of one's life, which in actuality revolve around the fear of death, are allayed or mitigated. Yeah, so the ultimate fear everyone has is dying. Therefore, they buy life insurance, they have savings accounts, they do so many things to in anticipation of death. Actually, only the material body dies. The soul is eternal. And that's another foundation of faith of the devotee. Krishna says that Dehinosmin yata dehi kumaran yovanam jara tatat dehantara prati diras tatra namuyate. As a person passes from boyhood to youth to old age, similarly, when one approaches, when one leaves the body at death, they are not bewildered by it. We've already died many times. Where's the body we had when we were 1 year old? It's dead. All the cells are dead. Where's the body we had when we were 16 years old? It's dead. All the cells died. And the final death is the end of life. But we already died many times in this lifetime. So a person, a dhira, is a sober person. They're not bewildered by this change of body because we've changed the body so many times during this lifetime. Why should we be bewildered by the change of life, the change of body at the moment of death? And if one has prepared for the moment of death, why should we prepare for the moment of death? Because Krishna says that what's going to happen to us depends on the consciousness we have at the moment of death. Yam yam vapi smaran bhavam tiyajat ante kalevaram tam tam ivaiti konteya sadatad bhava bhavita. In the 8th chapter and 7th verse, he says, whatever state of being one remembers when he quits his body, O son of Kunti, that state he will attain without fail. So, what state of mind will we have at the end of our life? Oh, that depends on what we did during our life. It says here, one's thoughts during the course of one's life accumulate to influence one's thoughts at the moment of death. So, this present life creates one's next life. If in one's present life one lives in the mode of goodness and always thinks of Krishna, it's possible for one to remember Krishna at the end of one's life. That will help one be transferred to the transcendental nature of Krishna or the spiritual world. If one is transcendentally absorbed in Krishna's service, then his next body will be transcendental, spiritual, not material. Therefore, the chanting of Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, is the best process for successfully changing one's state of being at the end of one's life. Well, what does the mantra Hare Krishna mean? We should ask that question. The mantra is a prayer begging Krishna, please, my Lord, protect me so I can always be engaged in your service. That's what it means. So if we always are praying like that, then Krishna will answer our prayer. A prayer is not, please, Lord, my business is not doing very well. Make my business go well. Or please, Lord, I'm losing my H-1B status. Please let me continue having H-1B status. That's not a prayer. That is basically a business proposition. Krishna is not interested in doing business with his devotees. But he lends an ear if we pray to him. So therefore, this prayer is an ideal prayer. It's not asking for anything material from Krishna. It's asking, please, my Lord, protect me so I can always be engaged in your service. Or as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, Nadanam, Najanam, Nasundarim, Kavitam, Va, Jagadisha, Kamaye, Mama Janmani, Janmani, Swade, Bhavatad Bhakti, Rahaituki, Twayi. He said, my dear Lord, I have no desire to accumulate wealth, nor do I desire beautiful women or beautiful men, nor do I want any number of followers. I only want your causeless devotional service, birth after birth. So that means he doesn't want mukti either. He simply wants, the real devotee simply wants to be engaged in Krishna's service. So that is a prayer. And Krishna will answer that prayer by giving us exactly what we want, eternally being able to serve him. Etan navidyamananam ichitam akuto bayam yoginam nripanirnitam harir namanakirtanam. So Sukadeva Goswami is explaining to King Parikshit, O King, constant chanting of the holy name of the Lord after the ways of the great authorities is the doubtless and fearless way of success for all, including those who are free from all material desires, those who are desirous of all material enjoyment, and also those who are self-satisfied by dint of transcendental knowledge. So, whether one is a karmi, a yogi, a jnani, or a bhakta, chanting Hare Krishna is the means and the end for all perfection. If you want to attain perfection in human life, therefore, sam siddhir haritoshanam, the perfection of human life is to please Lord Hari, to please Krishna. That's the way we attain perfection, and that is perfection. So at the moment of death, everything we've done during our life, all the good things and all the bad things, will appear. And if there are more bad things than good things, then we will have a very inauspicious next birth. So we should endeavor to do only good things. So, what are those good things? Those are, first and foremost, practicing the Yuga Dharma, the Dharma or the spiritual activity that's recommended for this age. So, what is that Yuga Dharma that is explained by Lord Chaitanya, where he says that he says, Krishna Varnyam Trisak Krishna Sangapangastra Parsadam Yajnai Sankirtanam Yajanti Sumedasaha. So he says, in this age of Kali, people who are endowed with sufficient intelligence will worship the Lord who is accompanied by his associates by performance of Sankirtan Yajna. So, people who engage in the holy Harinam Sankirtan are endowed with sufficient intelligence and they worship the Lord in the most favorable way by joining the Harinam Sankirtan. As we're going to do Saturday, if you want to be part of Lord Chaitanya's movement and engage in holy Harinam Sankirtan, come with us. We're going to Westlake Park and Pioneer Square. No, not Pioneer Square, I'm sorry. Pike Place Market. And hundreds and thousands of people will see us chant Hare Krishna. This is the movement of Lord Chaitanya. And this is the only yajna. In the age of Kali, the Sankirtan Yaga, the chanting of the names of God, is recommended by the Vedic scriptures. And this transcendental system was introduced by Lord Chaitanya for the deliverance of all men in this age. Sankirtan Yaga and Krishna consciousness go well together. Lord Krishna, in his devotional form as Lord Chaitanya, is mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam as follows, with special reference to the Sankirtan Yaga. Krishna Varnam Krishak Krishna Sangapangastra Parasadam Yajnai Sankirtanai Purar Yajante Su Medasaha. So whoever has sufficient intelligence recognizes that the best way to serve the Lord is to go on Sankirtan, which is the congregational chanting of the names of the Lord, the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, in public for the benefit of everyone. Then it's also said, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Iti Sudasakam Nam Nam, Kali Kalmasanasanam, Nata Paratarampaya Sarvavide Sudrishyate. The 16 words of the Hare Krishna mantra are especially meant for counteracting the sins of the age of Kali. To save oneself from the contamination of this age, there is no other alternative, but to chant the Hare Krishna mantra. After searching through all the Vedic literatures, one cannot find a method of religion for this age so sublime as the chanting of the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So, here's so much information about the glories of the Harinam Sankirtan. We should take it very seriously. Okay, so we're at the end of this book. We finished the book Matchless Gift. It's a wonderful book. And if we learn just this one book, it's enough to go back to Godhead. And so now we're going to begin the next little book called Civilization and Transcendence. Another wonderful little book by Srila Prabhupada. And this book has tremendous information in it. So the first chapter is called Religion with No Conception of God. And this is a replies to a questionnaire from Bhavan's journal, June 28, 1976. Religion with No Conception of God. Devotee, Srila Prabhupada, this questionnaire was sent to you by Bhavan's Journal, a cultural and religious magazine in Bombay. They are questioning various religious and spiritual leaders, trying to get the answers to some of the important questions that are perplexing people today. So there's a list of questions, and the first is this. Is the influence of religion over the masses on the wane? In other words, is the influence of religion decreasing? Srila Prabhupada, yes. This is predicted in Srimad Bhagavatam, 12th canto, 2nd chapter, 1st verse. Tatas chanu dinam dharma satyam sucham samadaya kalena balina rajan nankshati ayurbalam smriti. In Kali Yuga, this age of quarrel and hypocrisy, there shall be a waning or a lessening of these qualities: religiosity, truthfulness, cleanliness, tolerance, memory, bodily strength, duration of life, and mercy. So if you're having problems remembering things, that's a symptom of Kali Yuga. If you feel your bodily strength is going down, that's a symptom of Kali Yuga. If you feel as if the duration of your life is shortening, that's a symptom of Kali Yuga. If you feel as if nobody has any mercy for you, that's a symptom of Kali Yuga. And if you feel as if you don't have any time for religious activity, that's a symptom of Kali Yuga. These are the human assets qualities which make a human being distinct from the animals. In other words, religion, truthfulness, cleanliness, tolerance, memory, bodily strength, duration of life, and mercy. But these things will decline. There will be almost no mercy. There will be almost no truthfulness. Memory will be shortened. Duration of life shortened. Similarly, religion will practically vanish. So that means gradually human beings will descend to the platform of animals. Especially when there is no religion, human beings are simply animals. Any common man can distinguish that a dog does not understand what religion is. The dog is also a living being, but he's not interested in what is being discussed here about Bhagavad Gita or Srimad Bhagavatam. That is a distinction between man and dog. The animal is not interested. So when human beings are becoming uninterested in religion, then they're becoming animals. And how can there be happiness or peace in animal society? The big leaders want to keep the citizenry as animals, and at the same time they are striving to make a united nations. How is it possible? United animals? It is possible. Society for united animals? In the science of logic, it is said, man is a rational animal. So when rationality is missing, one becomes simply an animal. What is the possibility of being a human being? In human society, whether you are a Christian or a Mohammedan or a Hindu or a Buddhist, it doesn't matter. But there must be some system of religion. That is human society. And human society without religion is animal society. This is the plain fact. Why are people unhappy now? Because they are neglecting religion. One gentleman has written me that Marx said religion is the opium of the people. That means the communists are very adamant against God consciousness because they think that religion has spoiled the whole social atmosphere. Religion might have been misused, but that does not mean that religion should be avoided. Real religion should be taken simply because religion has not been properly executed by the so-called priests. That does not mean religion should be rejected. If my eye is giving me some kind of trouble on account of a cataract, that doesn't mean my eye should be plucked out. The cataract should be removed. So that is the idea of the Krishna consciousness movement, to remove the cataract from people's religious vision. Generally, modern so-called religious leaders have no conception of God, and yet they are preaching religion. What good is that religion? People are simply being misled. Real religion means God's order, dharmam tushakshat bhagavat pranitam. If your religion has no conception of God, where is the question of religion? Still, without any conception of God, they are professing some religion. How long will it go on artificially? It will deteriorate. That ignorance about God has resulted in the present condition. Religion means the order of God, just as law means the order of the state. Now, if in your social system there is no state, where is the question of the state's order? You will simply manufacture your own order. Today, that is going on in the field of religion. There is no conception of God, and therefore no following of God's order. But we devotees of Krishna have a clear conception of God. Here is God, Krishna, and he's giving orders. We accept those orders. So it is clear religion. But if there is no conception of God, no order of God, then where is the question of religion? Ask someone in some other religious system, what is their conception of the form of God? Can anyone tell clearly? Nobody can say, but we shall immediately say, Venum quanantam maravinda dalaya taksham barhavatam samasitam buddhisundarangam kandar patagoti kamania visesasobam govindam adipurisham tamaham vajami. I worship Govinda, the primeval lord, who is adept at playing on his flute, whose eyes are like petals of a blooming lotus, whose head is bedecked with a peacock's feather, whose figure of beauty is tinged with the hue of blue clouds, and whose unique loveliness charms millions of cupids. Brahma Samhita, 5th chapter, 30th verse. Immediately, there's a description. Here is God. Then there is religion. And if there's no conception of God, where is the question of religion? It is bogus. That is why religiosity and the other noble human qualities are declining. People have no conception of God, and therefore, there is no understanding of religion. As a result, the whole human civilization is declining. And because it is declining, human beings are becoming more and more like animals. Progressing beyond progress. Devotee. Question number two, Prabhupada. Yes. Devotee. The traditional charge against Hinduism is that it is fatalistic, that it inhibits progress by making people slaves to the belief in the inevitability of what is to happen. How far is this charge true? Srila Prabhupada. The charge is false. Those who have made that charge do not know what Hinduism is. First of all, the Vedic scriptures make no mention of such a thing as Hinduism, but they do mention Sanatana Dharma, the eternal and universal religion, and also Varnashrama Dharma, the natural organization of human society. That we can find in the Vedic scriptures. So it is a false charge that the Vedic system inhibits the progress of mankind. What is that progress? A dog's jumping is progress? A dog is running here and there on four legs, and you are running on four wheels. Is that progress? The Vedic system is this. The human being has a certain amount of energy. Better energy than the animals. Better consciousness. And that energy should be utilized for spiritual advancement. So the whole Vedic system is meant for spiritual advancement. Human energy is employed in a more exalted direction than to compete with the dog. Consequently, sometimes those who have no idea of religion notice that the Indian saintly persons are not working hard like dogs. Spiritually uncultured people think the dog race is life, but actual life is spiritual progress. Therefore, the Srimad Bhagavatam 1.5.18 says, Tasyaiva heto prayateta kovido nalabhyate yad brahmatam upariyada tadlabhyate dukavad anyata sukham kalena sarvatra gabhira ramhasa. The human being should exert his energy for that thing which he did not get in many, many lives. Through many, many lives, the soul has been in the forms of dogs or demigods or cats or birds or insects. There are 8,400,000 material forms. So this transmigration is going on. But in every one of these millions of forms, the business is sense gratification. The dog is busy for sense gratification. Where is food? Where is shelter? Where is a mate? How to defend? And the man is also doing the same business in different ways. So this struggle for existence is going on, life after life. Even a small insect is engaging in the same struggle. Ahara nidyabhaya maitunam, eating, sleeping, defending, and mating. Bird, beast, insect, fish, everywhere the same struggle. Where is food? Where is sex? Where is shelter? How to defend? So the Shastra, scripture says, we have done these things in many, many past lives, and if we don't get out of this struggle for existence, we'll have to do them again in many, many future lives. So these things should be stopped. Therefore, Prahlad Maharaj advises his friends, Srimad Bhagavatam 7.6.3, Sukham Aindri Yakam Daitya Deha Yogena Dehinam Sarvatra Labhyate Daivad Yatadukam Ayat Nata. My dear friends, Material pleasure, which is due simply to this material body, is essentially the same in any body. In dog's body, cat's body, demigod body, human body, insect body. And just as misery comes without our trying for it, so the happiness we deserve will also come by higher arrangement. A dog has a material body, and I have a material body. So my sex pleasure and a dog's sex pleasure is the same. Of course, a dog is not afraid of having sex on the street in front of everyone. We hide it in a nice apartment. That's all. But the activity is the same. There's no difference. Still, people are taking the sex pleasure between a man and woman in a nice decorated apartment as very advanced. But this is not advanced, and yet they are making a dog's race for this advancement. Prahlada Maharaj says we are imagining that there are different types of pleasure on account of different types of body, but the pleasure is fundamentally the same. So, yeah, Prabhupada gives the example. If you're sleeping, if a man is sleeping, let's say, in a park on a sunny day, so he falls asleep, and a dog is sleeping next to him, the dog feels the same pleasure of sleep that the man does. No difference. And if the dog is having sex and a man is having sex, the pleasure is the same. So, how does a man become differentiated from the dog? It's by the manifesting the qualities of truthfulness, cleanliness, tolerance, and memory, good memory, bodily strength, duration of life, mercy, and spirituality. That's how the man is differentiated. You don't. There's no difference between the sex life of the dog and sex life of a man. The sleeping of the dog and the sleeping of the man. The eating of the dog and the eating of the man. There's no difference. Both are feeling the same kind of pleasure. Therefore, Prahlad Maharaj advises, Sukham Aidri Yakam Daitya. My dear friends, material pleasure, which is due simply to this material body, is essentially the same in any body, dog body, man body. And just as misery comes without our trying for it, so the happiness we deserve will also come by higher arrangement. In other words, when we're born, already our happiness and distress is settled. It's already predetermined by our previous lives, karma. We can't increase it, we can't decrease it. It's not that you're increasing your happiness by working hard. No. That's an illusion. Naturally, according to the different types of body, there are some external differences in the pleasure, but the basic amount and quality of this pleasure has very well-defined limitations. That is called destiny. A pig has a certain type of body and is eatable is stool. This is destined. You cannot change it. Let the pig eat halva. That is not possible. If you offer him halva on one hand and stool on the other, he'll take the stool. He'll avoid the halva. Because the soul has a particular type of body, he must eat a particular type of food. Can anyone, any scientist, improve the standard of living of a pig? Is it possible? No, not possible. Therefore, Prahlad Maharaj says that everything about material pleasure is already fixed. The uncivilized men in the jungle are having the same sex pleasure as the so-called civilized men who boast, instead of living in that hut made of leaves, we are living in a skyscraper building. This is advancement. But Vedic civilization says, no, this is not advancement. Real advancement is self-realization. How much you have realized your relationship with God, Krishna. Jai Shri Radha Nilamadhava Ki Jai. Srila Prabhupada ki. So we'll stop right there and continue tomorrow in Civilization and Transcendence. Wonderful book. You can get this book from the bookstore. They have it in stock. Are there any questions? Yes, by praising. Yes.